Brain of Britain, the nationwide general knowledge contest, chaired by Russell Davis.
Hello, you join us once again in Salford under appropriately socially distanced conditions. Another four competitors throw their hats into the ring today in our tournament to discover who'll become the 68th official BBC Brain of Britain. Let's lose no time in meeting them.
Hello, my name's Malcolm Barracliff. I'm an office manager from Leeds.
Hello, I'm Derek Hayes. I'm a retired school teacher from Horwich near Bolton in the historic county of Lancashire.
I'm Sarah Hunt. I work in corporate communications for a police force and I'm from the Black Country.
I'm Neil Wright, retired biomedical scientist from the Wirral.
Excellent. Now, Malcolm, I gather you're a lifelong Leeds United supporter, is that right? And I'm told that as a boy you were at Ellen Road on a particularly significant night for the club.
Yes, I was. I think it was 1974. The night was the night Brian Clough was sacked by the Leeds board, and normally we were invited to go into the boardroom to see all the trophies. And unfortunately, that evening we couldn't. And of course, I was therefore one of the first to learn that Brian Clough had been sacked by the board after his 44-day reign.
Yes, 44 days, I remember that. But what was the problem, really, between him and the club? It never became very clear to me at the time.
Well, I think the players really didn't get on with Clough at all. Norman Hunter actually lived in the village where I was, and I spoke to Norman quite a while after the incident. His son used to live next door to me, and he basically said, you know, the players weren't going to perform for Clough.
Yeah. Derek, this is not the first time we've had you to take part in Brain of Britain, and you've been on quiz shows on TV too. Do you find you get a bug for it and you can't resist the temptation to try again?
I think so, yeah, although I still get very nervous before taking part. But it's very nice when one gets an answer correctly and accepted by you or some of the question master.
Yeah. As a visually impaired person, you must find there are some aspects of quizzing which cause a few problems. I mean, quizzes tend to have questions about things like what national flags look like and so on. How do you deal with all that?
Yeah, taking part in quizzes has sort of taught me how much, you know, how much one learns by one's eyes, basically. Lots of things I've not considered before, such as, you know, car logos. As well as colours and flags, but, you know, colours of flowers. There are so many things that, you know, as a visually impaired person, one's not really aware of. You know, I mean, I wasn't aware that cars had logos or that banks had, you know, symbols outside them with whatever, displaying, you know, until I started taking part in quizzes or, you know, or football badges. Even though I follow football, I might have gone to hundreds of games, but I'm not aware of a badge that a team might wear, or even the sponsorship name on a shirt.
It's a fascinating set of problems. Sarah, you've done some quiz shows in your time too, but you've also had some adventures in your past life as a journalist. Whereabouts in the world did that take you?
I didn't really travel for journalism because I was a journalist on a local paper, which is the Black Country Bugle. But I think you're referring to some of my adventures in Africa, particularly in Egypt. Sadly, a lot of the country is not as accessible as it used to be. So I was very, very lucky to travel, you know, thousands and thousands of miles throughout Egypt. Actually travelled up and down the Nile on an open-top felucca for a week, which is a fishing boat, which was very basic, but the most amazing experience to sleep under the stars and see the Milky Way from the Western Desert, for instance. So absolutely amazing country. Since then, travel's been mainly in Europe, and hopefully we're looking to buy somewhere to live in Italy in the future, so fingers crossed.
Oh, well, good luck with that, because that's where I'd go too if I had my choice. Neil, I'm told that genealogy has become an enthusiasm of yours, which you have in common with lots of people now for some reason. What's the appeal of it for you?
I think it's just finding a sort of sense of completeness, you know, sort of being able to trace people back through different generations as far as you can get to.
Have you managed to find out anything intriguing about any of your own ancestors?
Well, the one thing which came as a bit of a surprise was when we found that, I think it was my four times great-grandfather was hung for stealing sheep in 1806 in an accomplice, and left behind a pregnant wife and six children. Never quite worked out how they managed to get away, survive that. But
Well, obviously there's still work to be done. Well done. And there is here too. You're all very welcome, by the way. Or welcome back, as the case may be. There are, as you know, very few rules in Brain of Britain. You get questions in turn, and the questioning stays with you until you get one wrong or can't provide an answer. You're all clutching buttons, which trigger not a buzzer but a light to let me know you'd like to nip in for a bonus point if someone else doesn't get it right. Please respect the 10-second thinking time each contestant gets on their own question. And if you give your answer after the 10 seconds are up, remember, I can't accept it. If everyone's ready, we'll begin the first round today with Malcolm Barraclough's question. In the words of the 1980s hit song Africa by Toto, which mountain is described as rising like Olympus above the Serengeti?
Kilimanjaro.
Yes. In the human body, where would you find the ciliary muscle?
The ciliary muscles in the eye.
In the eye. It's a muscle that helps the eye to alter its focus, yes. Which European art gallery is home to the Vermeer painting Girl with a Pearl Earring?
The Rijksmuseum.
It isn't the Rijksmuseum, I'm afraid. No. Sarah Hunt?
National Gallery?
No. Derek Hayes?
Prado?
No. No. OK. It's the Mauritshuis in The Hague. Derek Hayes now. In the year of 1932, what unusual significance did April the 5th have in horse racing?
It won the Grand National.
Yes. Knowing the name, knowing that it's the name of a horse is enough, actually. You got the wrong race. It was the Derby. April the 5th won the Derby that year. Fred Lane was the jockey. I wasn't around then, but it was my birthday. Later. President Joe Biden has a German Shepherd dog whose name's also the surname of a 20th century British Prime Minister. What name is that?
Wilson?
No. Anyone else? Always worth a guess.
Macmillan?
Wasn't Macmillan, no. Sarah Hunt?
George?
No. And Neil Wright?
Churchill?
Not Churchill, no. It could have been Major. Major. And Major's comrade Champ died in June this year. They were a pair. Sarah Hunt, according to Virgil's Aeneid, which priest, later crushed to death by serpents, warned the Trojans not to let the wooden horse into the city?
Laocoon.
Yes. Esch-sur-Alzette, a commune with town status, is which European country's second city, as it were?
Belgium?
No. Derek Hayes?
Luxembourg.
Luxembourg's the right answer, yes. Neil Wright, we come round to you. What was the nationality of the pianist who won the inaugural International Tchaikovsky competition held in Moscow in 1958?
British.
No. Derek Hayes.
Chinese.
No. Worth a guess again. Sarah Hunt.
Hungarian.
No. Yes, Mark.
Romanian.
No, American. He was Van Cliburn, and he was given a ticker tape reception on his arrival back in New York, the first classical musician to be so honoured. End of round one. Neil Wright has yet to score, but Sarah Hunt has one. Derek Hayes and Malcolm Barraclough, two apiece. Straight on to Malcolm again. Which much-loved book of the 20th century opens with these words? I was set down from the carrier's cart at the age of three, and there, with a sense of bewilderment and terror, my life in the village began.
Laurie Lee, Cider with Rosie.
Exactly right. Closed in 1991, the Trawsfynydd nuclear power station was located within which UK national park?
Lake District?
No. Neil Wright.
Snowdonia.
Snowdonia, yes. It no longer operates, but the process to dismantle it completely could take as long as 100 years. Derek Hayes, Monoceros, a constellation in the Northern Hemisphere, takes its name from a Latin word for which mythical creature?
The Minotaur?
No. Malcolm Barraclough.
Unicorn.
Unicorn, yes, it is. Monoceros. Sarah Hunt, what was the name of the character created first on radio and then on TV by the late Caroline Ahern, a little old lady who used her apparent innocence to ask sometimes devastating questions of celebrities?
Mrs. Merton.
Yes. In a poll conducted by the Radio Times in 2019, which drama series with a Second World War setting was named as the 21st century TV programme that viewers missed the most? out of time, Derek Hayes?
Don't tell me.
It wasn't, no. Malcolm Barracloth.
Hello, hello.
No. Neil Wright?
Tenko?
No, it was Foyle's War. Surprising result to me. Anthony Horowitz's wartime detective drama starring Michael Kitchen as the eponymous hero. Neil Wright, which motto, a version of a riddle set by Samson in the Book of Judges, is inscribed beneath the logo of the bees and dead lion on tins of a well-known brand of golden syrup? No. Yes, Malcolm Barrow.
Is it honey sweeter?
No. You haven't looked at your golden syrup tin recently. It's out of the strong came forth sweetness. Might ring a bell now. According to the company's website, where bees produce honey from the dead lion's carcass, rich syrup pours from the well-loved tin. I'm not sure that adds a great deal, really. End of another round. Here are the scores now. Neil Wright has scored. He's got one. Sarah Hunt, Derek Hayes, two apiece. Malcolm Barrowclough now four. As we go back to him. And it's time for some music, Malcolm. 2021 marks the 50th anniversary of the critically acclaimed jazz album Journey in Satchidananda, released in 1971 by an accomplished pianist. In this piece, she pays tribute to her husband, himself a world-renowned jazz musician, who died a few years previously. When you've heard it, I'd like you to tell me her name.
Nina Simone?
No. No more offers. No, I fear not. Alice Coltrane is the answer, and the piece is called Something About John Coltrane. That was a tough one, actually. Derek Hayes, of the kings and queens of England or Great Britain since the conquest, which one was the oldest when they came to the throne?
William the Fourth?
It was, yes. He came to the throne in 1830, aged 64 years, 309 days. Edward the Seventh we tend to think of, but he was only 59 at his accession. At the 1952 Olympics, who decided to compete in the first marathon of his life, which he then won?
Zatopek?
Emil Zatopek, yes. He'd already won gold in the 5,000 and 10,000 metres. In the name of A.S. Byatt, the award-winning English author, whose novels include Possession and The Virgin in the Garden, what do the letters A.S. stand for?
Anna Susan?
No. No guesses? No. It's Antonia Susan. She's the sister of the author, Margaret Drabble. Sarah Hunt, your turn. Phineas Finn, The Eustace Diamonds and The Prime Minister are among the books that make up a six-novel sequence by Anthony Trollope, which is generally known by what collective name?
The Barchester Chronicles?
No. Yes, Derek Hayes?
The Barsetshire Chronicles?
No. Not that either. No more office, no. The Palliser novels, P-A-L-L-I-S, Palliser. Neil Wright, in which country will you find the celebrated winery Chateau Musard?
Lebanon.
Yes, in the Bekaa Valley too. How they carried on producing such great stuff with wars going on around them, I really don't know. Often used as an antiseptic or an insecticide, among other uses, which acid has the chemical formula H3BO3?
Boric acid.
Boric acid is right. The obelisk relocated to London in the 19th century, popularly known as Cleopatra's Needle, was brought there from which city?
Luxor?
No. Yes, Derek Hayes?
Alexandria?
Yes, it had been moved there from Heliopolis in the early 19th century, but not transported to London until 1877. It's one of a pair of identical obelisks, the other now being in New York. End of another round. These now the scores. Sarah Hunt, 2 points. Neil Wright, 3. Malcolm Barrowclough, 4. Derek Hayes, 5. And with the scores finely balanced like that, I think it's time to we let our brains sit back for a few minutes and treat one another as colleagues rather than as rivals. We take a pair of questions from our inbox from a listener who's hoping to beat the brains. You can email us your ideas for this part of the programme at any time by using the link on our web pages or by emailing brainofbritain@bbc.co.uk. That's what listener Jeff Cosson did. And it's paid off, because if our contenders today can't deal adequately with Jeff's questions, he stands to win a prize. See how you get on with Jeff's questions, which both have a historical flavour. An early 18th century European monarch is commemorated by riverside statues in both London and Rotterdam. Which monarch and why?
William of Orange, William III?
Yeah, could be early 18th century, yeah. Because he was the ruler of both countries at different times, I suppose. But should we give that? I can't think of any other.
What do you think, Neil?
Can't think of anyone.
Yeah, go for that.
William III, William of Orange?
No, I'm afraid not. It was Peter the Great of Russia. The statues commemorate his visits to both cities, where he was interested in finding out how modern shipyards were managed. And in London, Jeff tells us, he rented a house from the diarist John Evelyn, where he managed to cause rather a lot of damage by holding reckless parties, becoming Peter the Great Nuisance at that point. OK, here's Jeff Cosson's second question for you. Charles Ignatius Sancho and Olauda Equiano were both prominent figures in 18th century London society. They had various talents and have appeared on British postage stamps. What did they have in common?
Any ideas?
No.
They weren't to do with the early circuses, were they? No, or early... No, I don't know.
I was thinking of acting or entertainment of some sort.
Well, I sort of stamped in the... They were famous jesters for the monarchy.
No, what they were was they were both freed African slaves. Sancho was a composer and actor and thought to be the first African to vote in a British general election. Equiano was a prominent anti-slavery campaigner, and his memoirs recounting his experiences as a slave added a great deal of weight to the abolition movement. They were both featured on stamps in 2007. So, thank you, Jeff Cosson, for those interesting questions. Our brains enjoyed those briefly and failed the test, I fear, happily for you. So we'll be in touch with you about getting your prize to you very shortly. And by time-honoured Brain of Britain tradition, we send you on your way with a sweet-sounding round of applause recorded before the pandemic robbed us of audiences, and a sound we look forward to hearing again soon. Well done. I mentioned our email address, brainofbritain@bbc.co.uk, but you can also write your questions down and send them by post if you prefer, and there are plenty of people who don't have regular access to email. Send them to Brain of Britain, BBC Dock House, Media City UK, Salford M50 2LH. Remember to include the answers and your contact details so we can get in touch if we decide to use your suggestions in a future edition. Right, break time over. Let's resume with the next round. Fingers back on buttons, and it's your turn again. Malcolm Barraclough. Max Hill, Dame Alison Saunders, and Sir Keir Starmer are the three most recent holders of which public office?
Leader of the Opposition?
No. Derek Hayes.
Director of Public Prosecution.
Is the right answer, yes. And it's your question. Music now. From a charismatic British jazz trombonist and band leader who died in March 2021. After you've heard Morning Train, I'd simply like you to name him.
Chris Barber?
It was Chris Barber, yes. And even Ronnie Scott was on that. a recording by Chris Barber, but he always was an inclusive band leader. In which year was the guillotine first introduced in Paris?
1791?
No. Sarah Hunt?
1790?
No. Surely a guess. Yes,
1789.
Right. Sorry?
1789.
Not 1789 either. It's one left.
1793?
No, 1792. You're all around it. At the beginning of the phase of the French Revolution, which came to be known for obvious reasons as the Terror. Sarah Hunt, then, the trivium, the introductory course studied at a medieval European university, consisted of three liberal arts: grammar, rhetoric, and which other?
Mathematics?
No. Derek Hayes?
Logic.
Logic. Well done, that is the right answer. Neil Wright, the song Nymphs and Shepherds, with music by Purcell, was made famous on record in 1929 by the Manchester Children's Choir and the Halle Orchestra under its conductor of that day. Who was that conductor?
Sir John Barbirolli?
It wasn't, no, before his time. Derek Hayes?
Malcolm Sargent?
No. Sarah Hunt?
Arnold?
No. You're right, no. OK. It was Sir Hamilton Harty, a name I've always liked, but I don't think he was there very long. End of another round. And the scores have changed a little bit. Sarah Hunt, 2. Neil Wright, 3. Malcolm Barraclough, 4. Derek Hayes, 8. And, Malcolm, it's your turn again. What did Pickles the dog discover under a garden hedge in Norwood, South London, in 1966?
The Jules Rimet trophy.
Yes, it had been stolen from a hall in Westminster where it was on display. You're right. Prized by the Japanese for its distinctive aromatic flavour, what type of food is a matsutake?
A mushroom?
It is a mushroom, yes. Which familiar cosmetic item, although patented in 1911 by Anna Taylor of Ottawa, really came to prominence a few years later after being used in D.W. Griffith's silent film epic Intolerance?
Lipstick?
No. Guesses? Yes, Derek Hayes?
Mascara?
No. Sarah?
Eyeliner?
No. It was false eyelashes. Actually, it's strange to relate. Derek Hayes, in astronomy, if apogee is the term used for the point in the orbit of the moon at which it's furthest from the Earth, what word is used for the point in the orbit of the moon when it's closest to the Earth?
Perigee?
Yes, perigee. In recording technology, what do the letters SA stand for in the format known as SACD?
Standard acoustic?
No, very good suggestion, but not right, I fear. Any guesses forthcoming? No.
Stereo audio?
No. No, no. It's very unscientific sounding. Super audio is all it is. Super audio CD. Sarah Hunt, music for you now, and you're about to hear part of a Mozart symphony, which I'd just like you to name.
Jupiter?
Yes, the Jupiter Symphony No. 41. That was the beginning of the second movement. Which Labour Chancellor nationalised the Bank of England in 1946, then resigned office in November of the following year, having leaked details of the autumn budget to a journalist?
I cannot think of his name.
Fair enough. Derek Hayes can?
Stafford Cripps?
No, it wasn't. No more tries. No, Hugh Dalton is the answer. And leaking budget details has hardly been regarded as a resigning issue by more recent chancellors. And over to Neil Wright now. A compound of two Persian words, five and water, which Indian state's name thus means land of five waters or five rivers?
Punjab.
Yes, also the name of a province of eastern Pakistan. According to Violet Bonham Carter, the daughter of Prime Minister Herbert Asquith, which political figure said, "We are all worms, but I do believe that I am a glowworm."
Churchill?
It was Winston Churchill, yes. Well, guessed if it was a guess. In gemology, diamonds are described and assessed by a globally accepted standard known as the four C's. Two of these four C's stand for carat weight and cut. Can you name either of the remaining two C's?
Colour.
Colour
well,
is
I think
one.
The other's clarity.
It is. There you've got both of them. That's very good. Said to be the world's oldest scientific prize, what is the name of the medal awarded annually by the Royal Society for outstanding achievements in research in any branch of science?
No.
No. Okay. Derek Hayes?
Fields Medal?
No. Malcolm?
Royal Harrison. Society Medal?
No. There around, how we go? No. It's the Copley Medal, C-O-P-L-E-Y. End of another round. Scores now interesting. Sarah Hunt 3, Neil Wright and Malcolm Barraclough 6 each. Derek Hayes 9. And we come to another round, and I do have to warn you people that it is the final round of the contest. So, this is your last chance. But there's a chance for everyone here. Malcolm Barraclough, in which 2009 film directed by Ken Loach does a postman receive some life coaching from a famously philosophical footballer?
Is it Life with Eric?
No.
Oh, it's... Oh.
Derek Hayes?
I, Daniel Blake?
No. Sarah Hunt?
Looking for Eric.
Looking for Eric is the correct title, yes, which, of course, features Eric Cantona. Derek Hayes, one of the most famous tourist attractions in any zoo was London's Guy the Gorilla, who died during a surgical procedure in 1978. Alliteration aside, why was he called Guy?
After in Bolton.
No. No. That's a very good suggestion, but it ain't the right one. Sarah Hunt?
Is it after the head keeper?
No. Nobody going to invent one? No. It's because he arrived at the zoo in exchange for a tiger on Bonfire Night, 1947. So he was actually named after Guy Fawkes. Sarah Hunt, your question. After defecting in 1961, who went to dance for the Grand Ballet du Marquis de Cuevas?
Nureyev.
Rudolf Nureyev is right. In which Olympic sport might a piaf be performed?
Dressage.
Yes, equestrianism, dressage. Which evergreen plant, prized for its clusters of colourful showy flowers, has a name that derives from the Greek meaning rose tree?
Rhododendron.
Yes, correct answer. The sequel to Robert Graves' novel I, Claudius is usually referred to as Claudius the God, but that's not its full title. In its complete form, it's Claudius the God and his wife, who?
Livia.
No. Sadly, Derek Hayes.
Messalina.
Messalina, correct, yes. Neil Wright, it's your turn for a music question at last. Here's a great rock and roll artist with his rendition of a Lennon and McCartney song. When we've heard his interpretation of I Saw Her Standing There, I'd like you to name the singer.
When she was just...
Sounds like Tom Fogerty, but I don't think it is.
No, it isn't. Sarah Hunt?
Little Richard.
Little Richard, 1932 to 2020. I think to me it was the woo, the high woo that gave it away. And that's the end of the round, and it means that the final scores in this contest are these, and they're surprisingly close. Neil Wright, 6. Malcolm Barraclough, 6. Sarah Hunt, 8. Derek Hayes, 10. So very well done indeed to Derek Hayes, who'll rejoin us in London in the autumn at the semi-final stage. My thanks to all four of you today. It was a close and intriguing contest. We'll return to Salford for three more heats a little later in the season, but next week we'll be in London. I hope you'll join us for another Brain of Britain contest. Thanks for listening today, and goodbye.